This video is about installing the data acquisition system PteroDAQ on a TCLC board. It corresponds to sections 3.4 and 3.5 of the Applied Analog Electronics textbook. Now, the first thing you're going to need to do in order to run PteroDAQ is to have Python installed. macOS usually comes with a Python that actually will work with PteroDAQ. Windows systems usually do not. But even if you have a Mac, you're probably going to want to install a Python that has the SciPy packages in it for other things that we're going to do in this course, some signal processing work. It's not necessary to have all that signal processing stuff for running PteroDAQ. PteroDAQ is really minimal requirements, but you might as well install it now so that you don't get struggle with it later. And the package that I recommend for installing Python with all the tools, all the packages you might need in Python, is the Anaconda installation. The Anaconda individual edition is free, and the instructions for installing it are fairly straightforward. It does, however, usually take a long time to install the Anaconda version of Python because it's pretty big. It's got all of Python, it's got R, it's got lots and lots of Python packages, and installing all that takes a while. So set aside some time, do the Anaconda installation, and if you're running on Windows, make sure that when you do the installation of Anaconda that you check the box that says you want to be able to run this thing from the command line, because by default, Windows assumes you don't want to run your programs. It assumes that you only want to click on icons, and it doesn't install Anaconda properly so that you can run it from command line. You'd have to run it from some special Anaconda window, which is a pain. So try to check the box on the window installation that lets you run it from the command line like other programs. Okay, once you've got your Python installed, the next step is to get TeenCduino. Now, TeenCduino is a special version of Arduino, of the Arduino IDE, that understands the Teensy boards. And it used to be you had to install Arduino and then install the Teensy information on top of the Arduino, and it was a pain to do that two-step process. The PJRC, who make the Teensy boards, have now made it so that you can just install the entire thing, Arduino plus the Teensy information, in a single step. And the version that I used was this first one here, the macOS software. That one's one of the easiest installers to do because it isn't even an installer. All it is it's a zipped version of the application. So you just download that and unzip it, and you've got your application. And what you want to do with that application, once you've unzipped it, is to stick it in your applications file for the Mac. For Windows, I believe it comes with an installer, and it puts it wherever it is that Windows likes to put things. All right, so once you've got that TeenCduino application installed, the next step is to go to GitHub and get PteroDAQ. And there's two ways to do that. If you go to this code box here, you can either clone the repository, which is means you have a copy of Git and get it as if you want to modify it, or since you're probably not interested in modifying PteroDAQ, you can just download a zip file of the whole thing and unzip that, and you're ready to go. And do make sure you unzip it. On Windows, quite often you can look at things and it looks like they're all perfectly normal, but the stuff's all zipped up, and a lot of the programs won't run if the stuff's zipped up. It looks normal on Windows, but it isn't. So make sure you unzip that file. Throw away the zip file once you've unzipped it so that you've got just a plain directory that isn't compressed. That's about half the problems people have on Windows with PteroDAQ, is forgetting to unzip the file. And it's hard to debug because it looks the same whether it's zipped or unzipped. Windows doesn't distinguish very well between the two. But if it's not, if it hasn't been unzipped, it doesn't run. Okay, so once you've got that PteroDAQ file, the repository, unzipped, you should have a directory. And that directory, you want to give it a name and put it in a place where you can find it again. I recommend having a directory for the course, and in that directory having a calling the thing PteroDAQ. The name that it gets when you download it will probably have a lot of random numbers and stuff in it, because it indicates which version of PteroDAQ you downloaded, and you'll never remember exactly which version is which, so just rename the thing to be PteroDAQ so you can find it again. And here I did it all lowercase, though that's not usually the way to capitalize the name. The normal capitalization you can see up here was capital P and capital DAQ. DAQ is a standard abbreviation for data acquisition system. So hence the name here. You don't want to undo any of the, you don't want to move any of these files or directories around, just leave them all there. And what you're going to want to do is to go into the firmware and run the firmware.ino file with teensyduino. And it may not be set up to run out of teensyduino, particularly if you have another Arduino system installed. So I'm going to right-click on this on the Mac and say I want to open it with teensyduino. Notice I do have several other versions of Arduino here, but those aren't the ones I want to use. I want to use the teensyduino. And what that should do, it takes a while to start teensyduino, and it's sort of here behind my back, because it opens it in the middle of the screen and doesn't let you move that around. And it takes a long time to start because it's got a bunch of junk in it. But once it starts, it should bring up a window like this one, which has firmware and a whole bunch of other files. If you've moved that firmware.ino file out of the directory it was in, it's not going to have these extra files, and it's not going to run. So don't move stuff around. Just leave them in the directories they came in. That's where they belong. You can move the entire PteroDAQ directory to a different location, but don't rearrange stuff inside it. Okay, so when I've got to this point, I go up to Tools here for teensyduino, and I make sure that I've got the right board. The teensylc is the board that we usually give with a kit because it's the cheapest one that does a good job. You can use a teensy 3.1 or 3.2 also, but it's a bit more expensive board and really isn't really any better for PteroDAQ. And then USB type is serial, CPU speed 48 megahertz, optimize for fastest. That's not the default. Usually it optimizes for smallest code, but teensyduino is not, with PteroDAQ, it doesn't take up that much space. And so we're not short on memory space or flash space for PteroDAQ, but we want it to run as fast as we can. So run for fastest. Then when you've got those checked, you want to make sure your board is hooked up. Actually, this thing might not have even done all that if the board wasn't hooked up. So let's take a look what that means. Basically, it just means plugging in the USB micro cable into the USB port on your computer. And make sure that this is a real USB cable, not a power charging one that only has two wires. Because you want to have the data signals as well as the power signals. Okay, so all we need to do at this point, we've got the board hooked up and we've got the right board selected, is click on this upload button. Get on the right window here. And it'll say compiling sketch. And it'll take a little bit of time to compile it, but not very long. All right, and then it's going to try to upload. And if things work correctly, you will see that it flashed reboot OK, and then it says firmware INO hex 20% used. That means the reboot worked. First time you run your teensy board, it probably won't work. And that's why it's got this big warning here, press button on teensy to manually enter program mode. Because if it's not ready to accept the programming, then it won't accept it. Don't press that button unless you're reprogramming the teensy board, because when you press that button, it puts it into program mode and it expects a new program to come in. So let's take a look at where that button is on the teensy LC itself. You can see it's that little white button right there. If I press that, it's going to try and download the software. If I'm not running that little teensy program, then it's not going to succeed. And your whole system is going to be not working. So if you do accidentally press the button when you were using PteroDAQ or something and it stops working, go back to reloading the firmware. And generally, somebody messes up like this once or twice during quarter, and it's no big deal as long as you've kept Teensy Duino environment and the PteroDAQ firmware around. Reloading it doesn't take very long. Okay, so I'll show you what happens if you press that button. So I'm pressing the button now, and you can see it reprogrammed it, said reboot okay, and now it's ready to go. Okay, and once you've got that, you don't really need to have the Teensy Duino environment around anymore. So we can actually quit that, and we can quit from the Teensy environment also. Don't need that around. And now we're ready to run PteroDAQ. And to do that, we're going to need a terminal. And what you want to do is to do cd to the directory where you have put PteroDAQ. So notice that that's the same name as I have here, PteroDAQ. And if you look at the path I've got for that, it's Dropbox BME51 for videos, PteroDAQ, and that's what I'm connecting to here. So getting to the directory where PteroDAQ is. Can't do that. Well, where am I? PWD will tell me where I am. I'm already there. I can't connect further down to it when I'm already there. All right, so now I'm in the right place. All I have to do is type Python DAQ. And what that should do is it should pop up this PteroDAQ window here asking me to select a device. The Teensy board has to have been plugged in and have the firmware downloaded for it to recognize that there is a device out there that it can use for PteroDAQ. If it's not plugged in, if it's not got the firmware, this won't appear. And it may say something different if you're running under a Linux or a Windows system, because it's looking there for the devices that are PteroDAQ, but it doesn't always report them the same way. Pressing go should then run the graphical user interface, and I have a window here that should be native to the macOS, Linux, or Windows system. I can resize it. Let's actually test out PteroDAQ and see if it's working. So I'll add a channel. And notice that this is made channel 1 with on the pin A0, that's an analog pin. This gives me choices of other things. I can pick other analog pins. I can pick the differential pin. I can pick digital pins. But for now, I'm just going to look at A0, the one that picks by default. Let's look at it at 180 hertz so that if I've got a 60 hertz signal there, I can see it. And I can just start recording. Now, I've got a zero appearing there. Why? Because I've got a wire from pin A0 into ground. If I disconnect that wire, I've got noise. And this noise signal is what you will usually see when you've got disconnected wire. A lot of times when students are having trouble debugging something with PteroDAQ, they come to me or group tutor for help, and I look at the signal and say, I bet your wire isn't plugged in the right place. And they say, yes it is. And I go, well, let's see. And trace the wire, and one end or the other of the wire is off by one on the breadboard. So make sure, if you see a signal like this, 9 times out of 10 it means you've got disconnected input to your PteroDAQ. You're not using the channel you thought you were using. If I touch that wire, I can get a lot of 60 hertz noise going in there. And this is actually a good test that the wire is, you know, tapping it, you get the 60 hertz on and off. And you can also hook it up to 3.3 volts or down to ground. And you notice that this last signal here, that's telling you what the most recent reading is. And it's almost always zero. Sometimes it flickers up to one least significant bit above zero. DC here is the average over all the measurements it's made so far, and the root mean square, the RMS, is the standard deviation of all the measurements it's made so far. So if I unplug that wire again, you can see that the last measurement now, it's fluctuating a lot. It's about 1.4, but it's fluctuating because of the noise. If I plug it into the 3 volts, now I'm seeing about 3.3 3.3 volts that's there. You may also notice that there's a supply voltage being reported over on this part of the screen. That 3.3 volts is what it measured the supply voltage being compared to a reference that it has internal to the internal to the chip itself. Okay, when you're done, you can pause this. You can type in some notes about what it is you were recording. Here, I wasn't recording anything interesting, so I'm not going to bother making any notes. But usually, you're going to want to say what your setup was, what this experiment was all about. Those notes get saved as metadata in your file, so that later on, when you're going, oh, I wonder which file this one was, you can look at it and say, oh, that was the one where I did this, 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 and this, and have all that information about what the setup was right there with the data itself. So you always want to, when you're doing something real, you always want to put the notes in here explaining what it was you were doing, parameter values and stuff that you cannot see from just looking at the data. And you can click save. And that brings up a little box here that's got standard file dialog for saving. And again, since I wasn't doing anything interesting, I'm not going to bother saving that. When you're done, you can just quit this in the normal way of quitting programs. Here, because I haven't saved it, it checks, hey, you sure you want to do this? You've still got data there you haven't saved. And I can say, no, I don't want to save that, and get rid of it. Okay, that's the basic process for installing PteroDAQ on a Mac. It's similar on Linux, similar on Windows. Small differences, basically, in either the Anaconda installation or the Teensyduino installation. But basically, it's the same on all the machines. And you should have no trouble really getting this installation working. It will take a while, particularly for the Anaconda installation.